This started with an idea. Somehow, if we were given the opportunity, we could become more. If given the place and the time, we could build a nation where everyone could become more. We prayed for favor. We believed that out of many, we could become one. Though America was never simple, our nation did not give in or give up. We crawled, strived for dreams and freedoms we believed in, fought to hold hands as we learned to stand on our own. We are brothers and sisters. Our dreams are not dimmed by our tears. We have stumbled, but will not fall. It began with the idea that beliefs should not be dictated. Freedom was to be shared. Worship was the right of the individual, not the responsibility of the government. All of these things were self-evident. We knew it in our hearts. They were inalienable for everyone, endowed by our Creator, God-given. On this day, we remember our freedom, and we thank the God who provided it. May God bless America.
Welcome. That's the theme of the service this morning, so I figured I'd make use of that. But for openers, the order of service is going to be a little different this morning, so fasten your seatbelt as we have some changes. But right now we're going to stand and sing together our opening hymn, which is 383, This is a Day of New Beginnings. Amen. And as Christians in faith, each day, His graces are new each morning. Amen. Each morning is a new beginning. 383.
This is a day of new beginnings, a new end where I to believe what love is bringing, pray to rest the faith that's gone.
So today is the day of new beginnings, and we started a new beginning last week. Turn on your microphone. Oh, sorry. You can turn the volume back on now that I'm done singing. We started a new beginning last week, and which is an opportunity for you all to open your offer your prayers to God. Amen. We come in here, we're all coming from some place. We all had things happen during the week, good and bad, and we want to bring them to God, and we want to offer them up as prayers. We're not going to take time to have each person speak their prayer, so I'll open with a general prayer. And then as we all quietly meditate and pray in silence, I want you to lift up a name or a word that represents your concern or your praise, either one, and we'll allow those to float up to God, okay? So we've come into his courts with praise and thanksgiving, which is what he asked us to do. So let us be in the moment. Let us put behind us those things that dogged us during the week in the world. We've left them outside. We're in the presence of God, and we have his attentive ear because of our praise. So, precious Lord, we thank you for this day. We thank you for your audience. We thank you for the saving grace of your Son, Christ Jesus, and the presence of your Spirit. And, Lord, we know that our spirits communicate to your Spirit our prayers and concerns before we ever open our mouth. You've already heard our concerns, Lord, but we pray again in this moment. We pray in silence, and we lift up a name. We lift up a word so that we might know that you're hearing us, Lord, and we thank you for answered prayers, even when the answer to that prayer is no, because we understand that you know what we need. We know what we want. So, Father, we thank you for your parental oversight of us, Lord, to keep us in check. So, Father, at this time, we raise up our concerns to you, and we also raise up our joys. Father, we thank you for all that you've done for us in the past. We thank you for how you are currently working in our lives. But mostly, Father, we look forward with great anticipation to the things to come. As we follow you in obedience, and through our obedience, we receive blessings from you, blessings that we could never imagine. And Father, on the eve of our celebration of our nation's independence, we thank you for our independence. We thank you for freeing us from the bondage of sin. But Lord, just as we have abused our freedom in this country at times, we also abuse our freedom that we received in Christ. And sometimes we allow ourselves to be enslaved again by our prejudices, by our biases, by our desires. Lord, we ask you to help us remain free, to build a strong community in this country that gives us so much opportunity. So, Father, let us be faithful to you. Let us be faithful to our country. And let us, most of all, be faithful to our freedom and the freedom of others. May we respect everyone. And, Lord, may you bless us this day in our service. And we pray all this in the gentle and precious name of our Lord and Savior Christ Jesus. And all God's children said, amen. Amen.
Good morning and welcome. Welcome to the Vine Church. It's a pleasure to see everybody here this morning. I was just thinking during that first video and as we were offering our prayers, and Heather behind me said freedom through Jesus, and you mentioned freedom through Jesus, how fortunate and blessed we are that we can come to this place in this space in absolute freedom, because there's so many around the world who can't worship in public. Fear of being persecuted or even killed. And so I'm so glad that all of us have showed up, and my hopes and prayers that others can also find Christ in this space. But it's up to us to go out in the community and offer his salvation to others, and in humility expect nothing of it, but in a hope that they might find Christ as well. Just a few announcements. I know they're in the bulletin and they were up on the screens. This Tuesday, I believe we're meeting at 11 o'clock. Maybe Nancy wants to speak to this a little more to set up. I believe we're setting up again in front of CAST. We're going to set up a table and whatever we can to let our name be known and hand out water bottles to those who are participating in the parade. So I would ask everybody, make a showing. I'm going to try and get there with my grandkids, and we'll see. Drag them out of bed. And we would ask if you have them, wear your Vine t-shirts so we can get that name out there. Just be wonderful. I'm sorry, 11 o'clock we're going to meet in front of CAST. Yeah.
On Tuesday?
On Tuesday. The parade is Tuesday.
Yeah, we don't have Sunday being started, but
now you've been told. Be there at B Square.
Bobby's not here. We'll play her.
Are there any other announcements? Okay, well then if you are able, would you please rise as we join in the prayer of illumination? And let us read. Holy Spirit,
we welcome you here with us today. Your word is a lamp unto our feet and a light unto your path. Give us the grace to receive your truth, faith, and love. And strengthened to follow the path you set before us. Through Jesus Christ. Amen.
Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path.
Matthew 10:40-42. Whoever receives you receives me. And whoever receives me receives him who sent me. The one who receives a prophet, because he is a prophet, will receive a prophet's reward. And the one who receives a righteous person, because he is a righteous person, will receive a righteous person's reward. And whoever gives one of these little ones even a cup of cold water, because he is a disciple, truly I say to you, he will by no means lose his reward. The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you,
John. Hi! It's your neighbors, Jim and Joanna Sanders.
From next door.
How are you? Hey, hey, we totally know that you don't like going to church with us, so we're not even here to invite you to church, all right? We're not even here to tell you the four little happy hops to heaven.
No. We're not even here to sell you fire insurance, you know, from down there.
Get that hell?
Yeah.
No, no, no. Hey, honestly, yeah. What we want to do right now is we just want to serve you through the blood of Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
Huh?
Yeah.
That's a good thing.
Okay, don't be afraid.
Hold the phone. Now, we know that you don't get us.
No.
And why should you? You're a heathen.
That's
we get
right.
that, all right? Yeah. So what we want to do is just be here to understand you and to serve you in some ways. You know, what can we do for you? That's what Jesus asked all the time.
Yeah.
Now, we noticed on your mailbox that you had some balloons out there. Did someone die? Can we offer some condolences?
No. Oh, you had a baby.
Oh. Pink means joyfulness. I get it.
I told you.
Okay, but how about this? Can we wash something for you? You're probably tired.
That's a great idea.
Maybe we could wash your dishes.
Yeah, or wash your car.
Wash the lawn.
Wash
the mailbox. Wash the dog.
Oh, he said wash the dog.
We could even wash the washer for you.
Not. Oh, he said not.
I love putting that word at the end of a sentence.
Do it again.
I got nothing. Not. You see what I did? I brought the comedy back around. I'm sorry. No, really. How about we not do any of that, but we just come to do what we should do, and let us just wash your feet.
Yeah, because you know, hang on. I'm not done. Jesus washed the disciples' feet, and so we want to wash your feet.
Yeah, we know you're not our disciple. Yet. Hold on. Here. Look, all right. One more do is I just got this water basin here, and I just want to wash your foot.
Yeah.
All right. Now stick out your big toe. Just stick out your big toe.
Come on. No.
This will be over in just a minute.
Yeah. It just takes a second.
Okay, now I got the shoe. Now just give me your toe, all
yeah,
right?
Just
come on, just give me your
toe.
Well, that's a fine howdy-do.
I know.
All right, well, we'll just leave the shoe here.
We'll leave the brownies.
I guess we'll go next door.
Okay, can I talk more this time?
It's not your place, baby.
Okay.
What a friend we have in Jesus.
I think it's time to sell the house. Well, hello again. Our sermon today is building on the scripture and the message from last week, and the theme is welcome. So, Father, we welcome your spirit today, Lord, and we ask that your spirit be what offers your message to your children today, Father. So push aside everything in me, Lord, so that it might be your voice speaking to your children. And I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. So last week, during a sermon, we were talking about renewing your mind, right? And it came from the scripture that directly precedes the scripture that we just heard Joni read for us this morning. And what happened was Jesus was preparing to send his disciples out into the world. But before they went out as representatives of Jesus, they had to look at things the way that God looks at things, which is spiritually. We're all born into the world. We all have various levels of intellect. Just about everybody in this room is ahead of me, but it's okay. God gives us each a measure, but there's more than intellect, right? There's wisdom. How often have you heard the story, a kid goes off to college, he gets a 4.0 or she gets a 4.0, but they don't know how to open a box of cereal, right? Or they're really book smart, right? But in the way of the world, they struggle with things. So there's a difference between intelligence and wisdom, amen? So intelligence is something we're born with a certain IQ and we can hone that. Wisdom is something that we learn through experience, amen? And it's the gold of having relationships with older people, people that have been there before you. And we know as children when we were growing up, we didn't understand that at all because like you, like me, were probably much smarter than your parents when you were young, right? And then you discovered maybe you weren't so smart after all. So it's the same thing in life with the Spirit. You know, we learn so much, and we have talents and graces, but there's a whole nother level of understanding, and it's a spiritual level of understanding, and it's accessing the wisdom of God. Amen? It's the wisdom that created the universe. It's the wisdom that created each one of you, stitched you together. And God wants to impart that wisdom to us, so that we might serve him more faithfully, and so that we might receive a blessing. And that's what we talked about last week, renewing your mind, getting rid of that old way of thinking, that old way of seeing things, and allowing God to open your eyes to the truth. Amen, Jesus? When Pilate asked Jesus, you know, who he was and why he came into the world, he said, this is why I came into the world, to testify to the truth. And it's the truth of all things, the truth of who God is, the truth of who you are, and the truth of what the world is. And when we accept those things, we can navigate the world much more easily, amen, and with all kinds of blessings. So what the disciples were told, essentially, real quickly to go over what you heard last week, is that the disciple is to be like their teacher. So we are to emulate our teacher, and who is that but Christ, amen? And who proctors us but the Holy Spirit? The Holy Spirit comes and helps us to be more like Jesus. And the big one, which was repeated oftentimes, have no fear. And I told you a story about somebody, I believe I told you a story about somebody I know that had I had gotten this person an opportunity for a good job to help them out of their economic hardship, and they never went. I arranged everything. At the job, and all they had to do was show up, and they would have had a great job, and they didn't show up. And I decided that the reason this person didn't go is they were afraid of failure. They were afraid of, what am I going to do if I get this job? What am I going to, you know, they were so insecure in who they were that they didn't even give it a chance. And that's what stops a lot of people from becoming Christians, becoming fully Christians. You know, they'll go as far as they're comfortable, but they're afraid what God has in store for them, right? I don't want to be a priest. I don't want to be a nun, but, you know, God has a great life plan for you, and trust me, I never thought I was going to be a pastor, never dreamed in a million years, and nobody that knew me thought I would be a pastor, except my mother. And my mother said to me, and she was particularly faithful, but she said to me one day, and you'll all agree with this, she said, "You talk so much that you are either going to be a lawyer or a pastor, one." So she was right. So see, Mom knows best. So have no fear. What God has planned for you, you are absolutely going to love. Trust me, even if it's something completely unexpected, and it probably will be. He said, "What I tell you in the dark, say in the light." When God is speaking to you in that private moment, this is something he wants you to share with others, how God's working in your life. And then my first favorite verse, I guess you could call it my first child, "Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind, that by testing you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect." But you have to undergo that transformation. Also, wisdom is imparted in words not taught by human wisdom, but taught by the Spirit. You've heard me say this before, absent the indwelling of God's Holy Spirit, we're nothing more than intelligent animals. We react just like animals, right? We have fear and greed. We're insecure. We run in packs, don't we? Humans are tribalistic. Look around the world. When these governments collapse, we break off into our separate tribes again, and the violence comes. So we have to be open to God's wisdom, not the wisdom of the world, all right? And finally, it is only God who gives us growth in the Spirit. It's not something we do on our own. Paul famously said, when someone said, "Well, I like Peter better than Paul," and I'm not talking about the singers, "I like the Apostle Peter preaching better than the Apostle Paul," or "I like Clopas," or "I like this one." What did Paul say? One plants, right, and the other waters, but it's God that gives the growth. This is like any of you that garden, you know, you get the seed, you till the soil, you plant it to the proper depth, you pack it down right, you're doing everything, right? No, you're just helping what God has already prepared. God has put the DNA in that seed, and God is the one that'll give it growth, and so he does with us. So now we discuss welcome. Now that your mind is going to be transformed, and you're going to see the way that God wants you to be, the next thing that Jesus spoke to the disciples was about welcoming, and we heard Joni read that. So what I want to talk about is the two sides of welcoming, how people welcome you when you serve as a prophet, when you bring God's word to somebody. Remember, that's all a prophet is somebody giving God's word to people, and also how you receive a prophet when a prophet comes to you. No matter how far along you are in your walk with Jesus, you're never done learning. You're never done receiving a word from somebody. Again, my mother said, "I talk so much I lose track of what I said and what I didn't say." I believe I told you also a story about I was sitting with a bunch of pastors, and all of a sudden, out of the blue, a woman pastor sitting next to me turned and looked at me and said, it was jarring. We were talking about something else. So she turns and she looks at me and she says, "God has a word for you. God just gave me a word for you." So I was kind of stunned. It could be very good or it could be very bad. And she said, "God says you have something on the back burner, and he wants you to take it off." And I was confused. I didn't know what she was talking about. And I thought about it. I thanked her. And I'm thinking, and okay, let's get back to business. And then I had to leave, and I'm walking outside, and I'm trying to think. As soon as I got outside, I said, "God, I need more information." I said, "I'm not sure." And this is the way you talk to God. Trust me. Don't expect that you're going to get it on the first pass. We're children. Tell me again. I kept praying, and I didn't get it right away. I made an assumption that it was one thing, but as I was working through things, and I sent Nancy a request, I sent her a picture. I said, "Would you print this out for me?" It was a picture of a pot sitting on the back burner of a stove. I did, and I put it on my bulletin board in my office so I could keep looking at it. And then I looked at my desk. And some of you might have a desk like this. It starts on the left side, it builds up to a certain depth in the middle, and then it goes back down to the right side. And whatever falls off the desk, kismet. And then I realized God was telling me, "You put everything on the back burner." And God was telling me I had gotten through my whole life that way. And this is the difference between transformation. I had learned how to navigate the world with minimal effort, because I'm basically a lazy person, honestly. God opens your eyes to who you are. So when I was in school, I did just enough to get an 85. Sometimes I got 90s, sometimes I got 70s, but I didn't study. I promise you this is the truth. In 10th grade, we had a very liberal school. You could go to class if you wanted to. You didn't have to attend class. I love history. I didn't feel like I needed to go to history. I went to social studies 16 times that year, and I got an 85. I just asked what we had to read. My mother was heartbroken. My mother, who dragged herself out of poverty because of education, because her aunt sent her to a college, gave her the opportunity to get an education, escape that cycle of poverty that her family was in, knew how important it was, and it broke her heart that I was not applying myself. But I learned how to skate. And then I found out I could do the same thing at work. I had a gift of gab, I could do just enough to get by, and I was always one of the better employees. Never the best, certainly not middle or lower, but just enough to get by. And so my whole life has been. And I've done pretty well. But God said, not for me, not for me. I want 100%. And that was the prophecy she gave me. So the point of that story is always be prepared to receive a word from somebody, to receive a prophetic word from somebody, because that's how God communicates to us. So it doesn't matter if you haven't accepted Jesus yet, you still don't understand, or you've been walking with Jesus for your whole life. It doesn't matter. When it comes to receiving a word from God, we're all the same. Amen? Amen? There's always somebody. Just happened in Bible study this week. I love doing Bible study with folks because people bring me fresh perspectives, or you read through things and you just see things differently. So we always have to be prepared. So in Matthew, Jesus said, whoever receives you. So there's two meanings to this. When you go out and you're going to share the gospel with somebody, when receiving you, it has two meanings. One means hospitality. So he was sending the disciples out and told them, bring nothing with you, because I want you to rely on the hospitality of the people that you're going to. So when we go out, we rely on the people receiving us, right, to be hospitable, to stop what they're doing maybe and listen to us, or invite us in for a cup of coffee, to sit down, whatever, to be hospitable. And Jesus says, if they're not open to receiving you, shake the dust off your feet and go on, go somewhere else. The other meaning for receiving you is to receive the message. Amen? Remember, we talked at great length about hearing versus listening. There's people that'll hear you, the people at the door. Imagine the Jehovah's Witness come there, right? And they start talking to you. Another really brief story. In my first marriage, there was this lovely older woman that used to come to the house. She was a Jehovah's Witness. And I would invite her in. I would receive her. And we would sit down at the table. And you know me, I talked to her for an hour. We sat there, we had our Bibles open, and we're talking, and my ex-wife is hiding in the bedroom. Is she gone yet? And then the minute the woman left, she said, why do you ask them to come in here? They're like cats, stray cats. They're just going to keep coming back. I said, hey, you never know who God's sending to you to give you a word. Amen? And at that time, I was just coming into the Spirit, and I was hungry to learn about the Bible. And I was willing to listen to about anybody. And she was willing to let me ask questions. So I welcomed her, and I believe I received a blessing because of that. Amen? So prepare to be welcomed and prepare to welcome, because Jesus said, whoever receives you receives me. So when that woman offered me a prophetic word and I listened to her and I thought about it, I was receiving Jesus. Amen? Because he was using her, the Spirit was using her to speak to me. So remember, we're Christians. Christ is the center of our lives. So we receive people to bring us a word, and we receive Jesus. And what was the whole point of Jesus? And he said it. And whoever receives me receives him who sent me. The whole point of Jesus coming into the world is so that we can be clothed in his righteousness, so that we could pray like we did this morning. Amen? Because I've accepted Jesus, God accepts me. God loved me anyway. But I can't be in the presence of God as a sinful person. Sin can't exist in the presence of God because God is holy. And that's what the word means. Holy, set apart, unlike the rest of the world. So I can't go in my filthy clothes. Ken Bowler can't go there. But Ken Bowler, washed by the blood of Jesus, can. And that's what we were this morning. That's what we prayed. So whoever receives the prophet receives Jesus, and whoever receives Jesus receives God. Say amen.
Amen.
Amen. It's about receiving the Word of God. And Jesus was known as the Word of God, and here is the Word of God. This is what will transform your minds. This will give you a new way of thinking. This is how the Spirit will work through you to give you understanding of what's in here so that you can accept Jesus fully, so that you can be in the presence of God. Then he says, the one who receives a prophet because they are a prophet will receive a prophet's reward. How much do you think that is? Well, what's a prophet's reward? Does anybody have any idea? Well, I looked it up. there's lots of thoughts about it, but your reward, well, what did a prophet do? First of all, a prophet was obedient, wasn't he? And I always tell you that that's how you receive a blessing, is through your obedience. So God says, hey, share the word, share the gospel, share the good news. Or you might get something very specific like that pastor with me. Tell him this. That happens. Hasn't happened for me yet. I've been on the receiving end of most of this stuff. Probably God thinks I still need a lot of work. But whatever it is, the reward for obedience is this. You make known to me the path of life. As we're obedient to God, he continues to open our eyes. He continues to give us more revelation, more discernment. And he shows us more clearly, that light shines brighter, the way that we're to go. In your presence, there is fullness of joy. We have joy. Remember those girls from the Oklahoma softball team? They were talking about joy, man. It's so much better than happiness. Because happiness relies on circumstances. Ah, man, it's going to rain. You know, joy, I get to clean out the closet. All right. Maybe you don't think that way, but you have joy in all things. At your right hand are pleasures forevermore. Forevermore. That means pleasures now. I receive pleasures. I mean, when you have the Spirit of God in you, you go outside and you look at the sunrise, right? And you just say, wow, thank you, Lord. Or you go out and you just stand out at Orient Point and you look out across the bay and say, wow, thank you, Lord. Thank you for this beach. Thank you for the sun, right? I mean, you're so thankful for anything. And it says forevermore. Because one day our time is done here, and we go to be with our Lord forevermore, and our pleasures are forevermore. Those things came right from the Psalms. What better place to get your answer, right? So when I looked up a prophet's reward, I went right to that psalm. I believe it's Psalm 16. You make known to me the path of life. In your presence there is fullness of joy. At your right hand are pleasures forevermore. That means in this life and the next. And then he says, and the one who receives a righteous person. So I already said, how do we receive righteousness? Who is a righteous person? Well, the only righteous person is somebody who's clothed by the righteousness of Jesus. Because we're not talking about what we consider righteous. We're talking about what God considers righteous. Amen? And God sent Jesus to be our righteousness. You really have to embrace that. You really have to understand that. There's nothing I can do. There's nothing you can do to be righteous in front of God. He gave his chosen people the law. And he said, all right, kids, now listen. All you have to do is everything in the law without ever making a mistake, and you'll be righteous. I wrote it all down for you. And nobody could do it. Because we're human. We can't do that. But the Bible says this is like a nursemaid. It was teaching us what we should be, even if we couldn't be that way. And then God himself came in the form of Jesus to be that one perfect person, human, that could live that life and be the one person that is righteous. And on the cross, he traded his righteousness for our sin. Amen? It's marvelous. So that's who's righteous. So the only way to obtain righteousness in God's eyes is to believe that his son, Jesus Christ, took your sin when he was crucified and gave you his righteousness as a gift, and that's called salvation. That's called receiving your salvation. And he says, because he is a righteous person, because they are a righteous person, they will receive a righteous person's reward. All right, we talked about a prophet's reward. What's a righteous person's reward? A prophet's reward is the result of hearing and obeying the message, right? I had said that. You hear a message, God puts something on your mind. There's different ways we receive this. In the middle of the night when we're sleeping, at 3 a.m., we wake up and God gives his voice. Sometimes we're just walking down, it's like a cold slap in the face. God will bring you a word. It might be through somebody else. A righteous person's reward is the result of following their actions to completion. So a righteous person is a person that knows what needs to be done in their congregation and does it. It's a person that sees somebody in need out on the street and helps that person. This is the way God wants us to live our lives. Not everybody is going to be a prophet, right? These are the different gifts of the Spirit. We all don't get all the gifts. Some of us get some gifts, some of us get others. And together we're like puzzle pieces, aren't we? We're like this broken loaf of bread. Many pieces, we come together to make one body. So my puzzle piece fits with your piece, and together as a collective, we become the body of Christ. So the righteous person is the person that does the work of the kingdom through the indwelling of Christ Jesus. And then he finishes, and whoever gives one of these little ones even a cup of cold water because they are a disciple, truly I say to you, they will by no means lose their reward. So how do you give somebody a cup of cold water? Well, that's part of welcoming somebody. Amen? So they come in. Hey, you want to come in? You want to sit down? We are hospitable. All through the Bible, starting in Genesis, they talked about hospitality. Amen? Receiving the stranger into your land. One other scripture, it comes from Romans chapter 15, and it's subtitled The Example of Christ, and he is our teacher, so his example is worth paying attention to. And I love the opening sentence from this because in my mind, this I see as one of the bigger problems in our congregations, all of our, not this one in particular, but we all have a measure of this. We who are strong have an obligation to bear with the failings of the weak. One of the greatest things God took from me was impatience. Man, that was me to a heartbeat. I had no time. I was so intolerant. I had no time if you didn't understand what I was trying to convey to you. I had no time if you messed it up. When I was a boss at the railroad, and I gave a job and you messed it up, I'd jump right down your throat. And again, God says, look, that's the way of the world, but that's not how we do business here. The way we do business here is we raise people up, because God reminds me daily, you are so weak. You needed so much work, and I came to you. You didn't call me. I came to you. This is what God said, and I have been transforming you, and how's it working out for you now, huh? Oh, a whole lot better, Lord. You know it. And it's because I had patience with you, and I sent people into your life to help you and mentor you, and that's the way we need to be. Just every person we meet, not in a condescending manner, but we should treat them like a child. It's not ignorance. Let's get rid of the word ignorance, and let's stick with naivety. Same thing, it just sounds better, right? They haven't had the opportunity to understand. That's how we lift them up. And remember, you're going to be on the other side of that coin at times, no matter who you are. Let's look at a typical problem, especially here, well, in the world, but the United States. I drove down Nassau Point last week. Jerry sent me on a mission. What's the name of that road? Skunk? Skunk Lane. And I notice rich people do that. Let's name it a really nasty name so nobody comes down this way. And let's not pave the road, and let's not put up street lights. Every wealthy neighborhood, I grew up in Belterra, Port Jefferson, was like that. So I drive down Skunk Lane on my mission, and as we get to the end, Angela and I drive like this. Look at these houses. Enormous manicured lawns, right? And then you get down to the end, and people on either side of the street have a water view. Holy cow. But you know what? There's always somebody that has a bigger house. There's always somebody that has a nicer view. There's always somebody that has more money. And if you're chasing against that, you're like a dog chasing its tail to the day you die. Amen? And it's the same way with our walk in Christ. I don't care how long you've been in the Spirit. I don't care how much you think you know. There's so much more for you to learn. And you always have to be prepared to be the student. And you have to welcome those that come to speak to you. And you'd be surprised who they'll be. Could be a much younger person than you. Because our age and maturity in the spirit is not measured in years. Amen. That's our age in the flesh. Some people grow rapidly in the spirit. Other people like me, you know, it takes a while. But we have to be willing to welcome a word from somebody to edify us, and we have to be willing to be patient with others as we're trying to instruct them. So those of us who are strong in the word or in any other way, we have an obligation to bear with the failings of the weak. It's also part of turning the other cheek. You know, somebody comes into your congregation and says something nasty or it just strikes you wrong, give it to God, let it go. Because this is where we work on our ability to be Christians to the world. It's to start by being Christians to each other. Amen? If we can't bear with each other, how are we going to bear with the world? And here's another one. And not to please ourselves. Something else. We like to show off our knowledge, don't we? Okay, Ken. Thank you, Lord. He just saved me from saying something I would have regretted. I have a friend. And the first time I met this person, he's quoting philosophers. He's quoting really deep theological things. I mean, this guy is obviously very well read. And he mentioned a poem. And just by God's grace, I happened to have read that poem that week. And I don't know why. It's called The Hounds of Heaven. And I was very interested. I'm not a poet. I'm not a big fan of poetry. But I looked it up, and I read about the author of it and everything. So when this guy mentions The Hounds of Heaven, so I say, oh, that was by so-and-so. And then the guy looks at me, oh, because his whole thing was he wanted to know stuff that other people didn't know. So he was using his knowledge to please himself. Amen. And I told him, I said, you know, you're pretty intimidating. And he smiled. He thought that was a compliment. And I was trying to tell him, no, you don't bring people to Christ by intimidating them. You don't bring people to Christ by showing off how much of the Bible you know or things like that or how much you've done. That's not how you bring people to Christ. You know, how do we talk to a kid? How do you talk to Piper? You get down on their level, right? And you talk to them like this because you don't want to intimidate them. And that's what I was trying to tell him, but he didn't get it. So we who are strong have an obligation to bear with the failings of the weak and not to please ourselves. Let each of us please their neighbor for their good, to build them up. For Christ did not please himself, but as it is written, the reproaches of those who reproached you fell on me. That's why we say give it to God. Somebody gives you a hard time, say, he's talking to you, Jesus. I know he wasn't talking to me. For whatever was written in former days was written for our instruction. Whatever was written in former days was written for our instruction. The same now as it was then. That through endurance and through the encouragement of the scriptures, which is the word of God, we might have hope. May the God of endurance and encouragement grant you to live in such harmony with one another. Amen. Harmony with one another, and it starts here, all right, as we bear with one another. In accord with Christ Jesus, that together, you may with one voice glorify the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. And here's the one voice. We don't speak from our own knowledge, we prophesize. And when we prophesize, we use the voice that's contained in the Bible, amen? The voice, the Word of God. Written through humans by the indwelling of the Spirit. With one voice, glorify the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, welcome one another as Christ has welcomed you for the glory of God. Amen. Christ welcomed me into his life so that I might be saved. That's what it just said in the scripture. What does your neighbor need? Don't go off to show off what you have or to show that you know or to show that you've got. What does your neighbor need? Give them that. And when they can't for the life of them understand why you're doing something like that, That's when you get to share the gospel, amen? Because of Jesus. And they'll say, what in the world does that mean? Then you get to share the gospel with them. What God has done in my life, and then you share, like I'm going to share with you, what God is going to do in your life, amen? So I welcome you to receive this word in the spirit that it was offered to you. Let's pray. Precious Lord, we welcome you here today, and we welcome each other. Father, you are the God of relationships, and I've learned that, Father. You've taught me through my long walk with you that the treasure of the universe is not gold, it's not diamonds, it's not a big house, it's not popularity, it's none of those things. All of these things are fleeting, and truly we learn as you open our eyes and give us a new way of seeing and thinking that all of these things come with their own burdens, don't they? The more money I have, the more I worry about money. The more popular I am, the more I'm open to being taken advantage of by others. All of these things have a cost. You've taught me, Father, that the true treasure of the universe is relationships. Loving people and being surrounded by people that love you. And the only way that I've learned to love people properly, Father, is by using the love that you showed me and extending that out to others. So, Father, thank you for welcoming us into your presence. Thank you for giving us a heart to welcome each other and bear with each other's shortcomings. We all have them. And, Father, we just ask you to continue to work in our lives. Help us to remain open to your spirit so that you might continue our transformation, so that we might have more of the abundant life that you promise we receive through obedience. So, Father, bless us all in hearing this word, and may we each welcome your spirit into our lives, and each leave with a heightened sense of your spirit. And we pray all of these things through your Son, our Lord and Savior, our propitiation of our sins, our righteousness, Christ Jesus. And all God's children said, amen. Now, in response to the message, we'd like to ask you to join us in singing All Things Bright and Beautiful, which is 147 in your hymnals. And Angela, I'm turning my mic off now. We're having communion today, and we are going to do it by intention once again. But next month, in response to a request, we're going to have our little individual cups of juice, all right? So we'll do things differently from month to month just so everybody can be accommodated. Amen? That's what we do. We make accommodations for each other, right? It's not about me. It's not about what I want. It's about what the other person wants. That's called service, and that's what God calls us into. So as we open, as we prepare for communion, the first thing we have to do to come to the Lord's table is to confess our sins. Amen? Everybody is invited to the Methodist table of communion. We don't use any alcoholic beverages so that everybody can participate. Amen? Grape juice and bread. And if anybody has any special requirements, food requirements, if you don't want to handle gluten, I don't think we're prepared today, but let us know, and we'll have something that's gluten-free for you or anything that you prefer. Just no Oreos, okay? It is the Lord's table, so. But let's start by offering our confession to the Lord so that we might have a proper heart as we receive communion with him. So let us read. Father, I come asking forgiveness when in positions of power I have used it to my advantage rather than lift up the weak. I haven't been as affirming and positive as I could be in my relationships and with people I meet. All that is because I have not leaned on your word. Please give me the endurance and encouragement I need to walk the path you have put before me and to welcome others as Christ welcomed me. Amen. Take this moment to offer up your own prayers of confession. Amen. I hear these words of assurance. The Word of God assures us that we are able to love through the Spirit of Christ. Let us go from this place with authority, knowing that God's Word gives us strength to love our neighbors near and far, and power to speak up for those who are broken. Thanks be to the Word of God. Amen? Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give our thanks and praise. It is right because God came to us. We didn't go to him. God came into this world to be the propitiation for our sins because there was nothing that we could do to be right with God. So God provided that for us. And when Christ came into this world, he ushered in the new covenant. And the new covenant is complete forgiveness through trusting in what Jesus had done for us. The church was established, and we were called into the body of the church to be Christ in the world. And it's through the indwelling of the Spirit that gives us the ability to perform that successfully. We thank him for all he's done, for his sacrifices, for how he created everything for us. And so your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join in the unending hymn, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed are they who come in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, Jesus took bread. He gave thanks to you. Sorry. On the night that he gave himself up for us, he took bread. And as he did in all things, and we as his disciples should emulate him, we give thanks as well. So we give thanks for this bread today, as Jesus gave thanks for the bread that night. After he gave thanks, he gave it to each of his disciples, and he said, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Likewise, when the meal was over, Jesus took the cup. Again, he gave thanks for all that God provides us as we give thanks to God for this day. He passed it to each of his disciples. After the meal was concluded, and he said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice, which is directly from the scripture that you heard last week in Romans, right? We offer ourselves as a living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. Would anybody require individual cups rather than share in the intention if you have a preference? My lovely assistant will provide you with that. Anyone else? And then Robert. If you have those cups, please hold them up. One more. We're getting there, baby. Would you hold those cups up if you received the cup? Heavenly Father, we ask you to pour out your Spirit on all of us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and the fruit of the vine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes in his final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit and your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Now, as forgiven children of God, let us offer up the prayer that Jesus taught us, the Lord's Prayer: Our Father, who art in heaven, to you that God asked us to offer ourselves as a living sacrifice, that we should be sacrificial in all that we do. And part of being a disciple of Jesus is to offer back a portion of what God has graced us. Amen? And he wants our total participation. It's not just about money. Some of us don't have the money to share. And you know what? That's perfectly fine. There's other ways that we can serve the kingdom. Amen? But please, having said that, please give generously so that we can continue our mission work in this community while the choir regales you, and we encourage you to join in with the Star Spangled Banner. Amen and amen. Gracious Lord, we thank you for all that you provide for us, Father, all that you provide. And today we return a small portion of it back to you for use in your kingdom. And as always, Lord, we ask for your Spirit to guide us in how we apply these assets so that we may be of the most benefit to our community, so that we might be the light that shines in the darkness, that we might be the candle on the sill and the city on the hill for a dark world. Father, use us, set us aside to your pleasure, but please accept this meager offering that we bring to you today. And we pray all of this in the precious name of our Lord and Savior Christ Jesus. And all God's children said, amen. Amen. You may be seated. Rusty, before you sit down, would you care to assist? You're a gentleman. Thank you. Hide that again. So, as usual, we'll be doing intention. Come up, have a piece of flatbread, try just to touch that one that you're going to choose, and then dip only the flatbread into the juice, not your fingers. The table has been set. The offering has been given. All those that wish to share in communion, please come forward. For those of you who with cups, peel back that first layer and show the wafer. This is the body of Christ given to you for strength. Amen? Amen. You may partake of that. Peel back the second layer and reveal the juice. This is the blood of Christ that was given for forgiveness of sins. Amen? Body of Christ given to you. Body of Christ given for you. Body of Christ broken for you. Body of Christ broken for you. Body of Christ given for you.
Remember, like this globe, we represent one body. And though we are all different parts of that one body, we come together, amen,
amen,
to be the church for the world.
Thank you for this mystery of communion, Lord. It helps. You gave us this sacrament to remind us that you dwell within us, to remind us of the sacrifices that you gave, and that through our communion with you, through our abiding in you, as the branch abides in the vine, we receive from you that we might have the fruit of the Spirit to do your work in this world. And we thank you for all these things. Amen. Amen. Now, would you join us in our closing hymn, number 431. Let there be peace on earth. Amen. And you know where that peace begins? With each one of us. Amen.
God of endurance and encouragement grant you to live in such harmony with one another in accord with Jesus Christ, that together you may with one voice glorify the God and Father of our Lord Christ Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. As a closing, we would like to sing America the Beautiful. And I forgot what number it was.
696.
What she said, 696. It's not going to be on the screens because I kind of sprung this on us last minute. 696 in the hymnal.